Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this occasion by one of the new faces of Scottish wrestling, the White Stag, Drew Mercury. Welcome to the show.
Hello, thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you for coming on. So I've been looking for a while now, looking at the Central Belt, because of course I'm up in the Northeast, and I'm seeing all these names pop up on Iron Girders and GPWA and all that. So I thought it was high time I get in touch with some of you guys and try and get you on the show so we can find out a little bit more about you, because they are Iron Girders and GPWA especially are producing wrestlers like at a rate of knots at the moment, which is quite incredible. So glad to have you on.
Thanks very much. And not only that, they're like producing some incredibly talented wrestlers as well. Like the amount of talent that has come through. I mean, I've only been doing this 2 years, and seeing just in that 2 years the amount of talent that's come from. It's crazy.
It's just
crazy
insane.
How quick. Yeah.
I mean, especially after the pandemic, it seems to be after the pandemic happened and places were starting to reopen again, everyone just kind of went through the thought of going, right, I might only get one shot at doing this, please, we'll just go for it and see what happens. And 2 years later, now we're seeing the fruits of that labor, and we're seeing all these names pop up. It's just, yeah, it's just fantastic for the scene and fantastic for, well, for me trying to get guests on as well, because that means there's a lot more people to speak to.
plenty to choose from.
Exactly.
Definitely, like you said, with the lockdown, I think that kind of gave people a lot of sort of a new insight into life, kind of like just being locked away for all those months, kind of like, what am I going to do coming out of it? So definitely, I think that's been caused that, like a big boom of talent for sure.
Yeah, I mean, some of us were quite happy to stay indoors, like myself. I mean, I got sent home to work March 2021, and I have not went back to the office since. So it's been, and because of this, I've now got the podcast, and this is my social interaction. Because if anyone meets me at shows, I'm very awkward. So it's a nice way to do it, and I get to hear your stories at the same time. So we'll start right back at the start. How you became a fan? So how did you become a fan of pro wrestling? Do you have any first memories?
Yeah, the first memories I always go back to, probably, I think it's quite a common thing for my age group, it's Jeff Hardy. Like, going back, watching Jeff Hardy. I was really into parkour when I was younger. So seeing also the kind of extreme high flying that Jeff Hardy used to do, it was, yeah, I loved it. Just fell in love. I just kind of became like an adrenaline junkie, I suppose, with that. And I loved that Jeff Hardy was going to do all these crazy things. So whenever I think of my earliest memories of wrestling, it's the question that like, I get asked often. It's just Jeff Hardy. Like that's what made me fall in love with wrestling. And then from then, obviously spiraling and then finding all these other incredible wrestlers at the time, you know, 2007, 2008, you got John Cena became like absolute idol, only for like that period of time though. And then coming across wrestlers that absolutely hated like CM Punk for what he did to Jeff Hardy and that, kicking him out of WWE. So it's, yeah, so my earliest memory back 2007, it was the whole Jeff Hardy Matt Hardy feud. Like, you know, Matt Hardy burnt down Jeff Hardy's house, I believe it was, and then it led up to the match that like WrestleMania 25, and that was, yeah, it was all of that, and then just, that's where it began, really.
That's what people don't remember is the storyline was, yeah, he burnt down Matt for some reason, burned down Jeff Hardy's house, and then he killed his dog in the fire.
Yes,
and,
yeah,
like all that. I had a wee moment thinking you're too young to know Jeff Hardy, because when I started watching, Jeff Hardy was my favorite wrestler, and that was 99. So as soon as you said CM Punk, I was like, I'm with you now. Okay, cool. Right, this is the
we know where we are.
The renaissance of Jeff Hardy. After I think was it TNA? Was that before TNA? That was before TNA.
Before, I suppose it was just before his
Victory Road.
Turned TNA, kind of. Yeah, it was the end of his WWE line, for sure.
Yeah. So, but yeah. Jeff Hardy's one of those guys, he comes up quite often, especially your age and weirdly my age as well. So there's kind of two generations of fans that it's just, yeah, Jeff Hardy was just so charismatic, pardon the pun for charismatic enigma.
But
it was one of those weird things that he never was the talker though. He was never a guy that you would speak into a building, but he would do something crazy and like you're saying, mad, that you'd go, oh, I need to see Jeff Hardy. I need to go see Jeff Hardy wrestle.
Yeah, you want to see more, don't you? You just want to see more of it constantly.
Have,
and,
did,
yeah, I just loved that kind of high flying kind of aspect. You know, Rey Mysterio as well. I forget that much. I loved Rey Mysterio when I was younger also. And it was just all this high flying, just like seeing people just doing crazy stuff, really. That's what I loved.
So parkour, you said
So,
that seems very apt for a point I'll probably bring up later on when we're speaking about your in-ring career. So what's that, 2007, 2008? So when did you think at that point, so you're into parkour, was that the thing that you wanted to do to try and get you into wrestling, or were you not sure you could do it? So you're like, oh, I'm going to do something like wrestling adjacent to get my adrenaline fill.
Not really, to be honest. They're both kind of two separate separate things. Really, for parkour, for me, was it was hot off the heels of Assassin's Creed 2 and Mirror's Edge, where I was just like, oh, this is really cool, jumping from this building to that building. That me and my friends both kind of started doing parkour around where I'm from a place called Dingwall up north. So we're just kind of out this town just jumping off things, really. I say parkour. I actually said a lot, like, it was just more jumping off things, and then as I kind of got older, it was more just kind of actually doing the proper, actually going from destination A to destination B with it. But for wrestling, it was more, it's kind of one of these things that I just kind of always wanted to do. One of those things that I think everybody when they're younger loves wrestling and say, oh, I'm going to grow up to be a wrestler, and everybody goes, all right. And it's kind of more, well, I'm going to prove you wrong. Like, I'm gonna do it. And I always told myself, if I ever moved down to Glasgow, I'm gonna do it. And I originally moved down to Glasgow in January 2020 to start with GPWA's May sort of intake. And then, of course, COVID happened and that all got pushed back. And then I found my way to Iron Girders instead because they were doing the non-contacts, like socially distanced one-to-one, which was more just kind of like drills, kind of more running drills and like learning your roles and doing running drills and stuff. There wasn't any contact of that. So, and that's how I ended up finding my way into girders. But yeah, it was more of a, I'm going to do it. And if I ever find myself down at that neck of the woods where there is schools, I'm going to do it. And that's how I came across Kim Wrestling. So yeah, they're separate, but the parkour's definitely helped me.
So, I mean, that's a fair distance to go between Dingwall and Glasgow. I went to Dingwall once. End of
Emphasis on
that
the once.
story. But
Once
occasionally,
never went back, don't blame you.
I mean, occasionally wrestling would come to Dingwall though. So, were you aware of a local scene at all when you're up there? So, I think WTL ran shows there, Rock and Wrestle did a couple shows there. Were you aware of that?
So, not really. So, actually, my first ever wrestling show that I ever attended was a Rock and Wrestle show. I won tickets to it actually in 2018, I believe it was. And that was like the only time I ever really came across wrestling up north, really. I did always hear about shows happening in Inverness. I always knew Rock and Wrestle kind of the Ironworks, and they went to the Mercer Hotel. Mercer, I think that's what it's called.
Mercury or something like that, I don't know.
Something like that. And they kind of brought it up there. But other than that, no, there was wrestling thing once when I was, again, probably about 7 or 8, but never went to it. So my first show wasn't actually like I was 18, so I knew of them, but never attended them really.
Remember what was on that show, that Rock and Wrestle one?
Briefly, so I know that Jack Jester was the Highland Champion, because I've got a because part of the winning the tickets was I get VIP access, so I got to get a picture with Jack Jester in the title, so I've got that picture somewhere, and that's great. Like, that just gives me a goal. I want to win the Highland Championship just to kind of relate back to that picture at some point, which would be great. But who else was on that show? I know Luke Cairo was on the show. These were when they were youngins. I'm sure Luke Cairo was on the show, and Leighton Buzzard. I believe Logan Smith and Angel Hayes were on it as well. But I'm really, really digging my me memory at that point. I remember clear as day Leighton Buzzard because he was still doing the kind of Phantom of the Opera kind of gimmick that he used to do. Kind of had like the mask and take it off.
All
I'm sure
right,
he used to
okay.
do something like that. So it was a while back, but
I'm
Govan
just
team, I believe they were on it as well. So yeah.
trying to find the results for it. I don't seem to have them from 2018. I've got from 2016 because I was at that one. That's the reason why I was curious
All right, yeah.
because that was the one I was at, and it was Colt Cabana and Sonjay Dutt that were on the show in Dingwall. So,
Oh, Dingwall, even better. Wow, Coco Bana. That's a shame.
That was a weird day because I drove them from Aberdeen to Dingwall, another Dingwall. I'm not slagging off Dingwall. That's a shame. I live in Elgin. It's not much better.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay.
So if you find yourself in Glasgow and you're like, that's it, we have to do it, and then of course the world ended. But so you said you're aware of a little bit of a scene, but GPWA, how did that come about? Is that because of meeting Jack Jester and going, oh, I know what Jack Jester's about. He trains here, he coaches here, so that's the place I want to go.
I didn't actually know who the coaches were going in. GPW, I was kind of just like, when I Googled it, it was the first one that popped up. There was obviously Source and I believe PBW as well. But I think if I remember correctly, GPWA, they had a website, whereas the other two didn't. So you could actually look and find information about GPWA. Mm-hmm. So that was kind of like more the sense that I knew more about that than any of them, because it actually gave like a breakdown of what you expected.
Right.
So with that was probably why I chose GPWA, because I actually could see the information. But when I went to Iron Girders, they were the ones that kind of went, you know, GPWA also do classes, they're doing like a full intake. We've popped your name down for it if you fancy it. And I was like, yeah, sure. So they kind of put me in the right direction as well to GPWA.
Excellent. So that first, of course, you have a little bit of a background of athletic background and with doing the parkour stuff. But what was that first couple of sessions like? Was it a reality? Was it a reality check as soon as you hit the ground? What was it like?
Yeah. So yeah, when I moved from Dingwall down to Glasgow to do wrestling, I'm asthmatic, so my cardio's never been great, and I was like, wrestling's going to be easy. Like, it's not going to be that bad. I'll be able to do it. No, it is absolutely the total polar opposite of what I expected, because the cardio is intense. I picked up, obviously, with my parkour, thankfully, like, we do rolls, and I picked up all the rolls really quickly because it's what I was used to doing. But when it came to things like, you know, doing the actual cardio, hitting the ropes, like, the ropes are, they're solid, they're sore. And then, you know, your first bump and all that, I was like, oh, that is not, you know, that's not what you hear. That's not hundreds of padding that you always hear all these people talk about. And it's, yeah, it was a total different, like completely different compared to what I expected. I thought it was going to be an easy journey when it wasn't. It wasn't. It was a tough one. And but I suppose I had the motivation just to keep going. And keep going with it.
Well, I mean, if you've travelled all that way down hundreds of miles to, in your mind's thinking, right, I'm here, I'm going to do it. It's how that are going back up to the north and maybe never exploring that opportunity. So it's sink or swim, I suppose, at that point, isn't it?
100%. I think it's more also, I can be quite a stubborn person. So it's like the two factors. One, I want to prove everyone that said, yeah, okay, wrong. But it's also just like the sense of, I guess, failure if I went back. You know, I don't want to like go all the way back then and be like, oh, well, I failed that. It was more like, no, I need to succeed for me, especially. And it's not for anyone, it's just for me. I know if 20 years down the line, sitting doing whatever job I could have at that point, just looking back going, I could have gone and done wrestling. Like, I had that chance and I didn't do it. So it's more, I didn't want to be sitting back thinking, what could have been, what if, do it. And then if it didn't work out, at least I tried. And at least when I'm 20 years down the line, I look back and say, like, what if? Well, you know, I did try it. I couldn't do it. So I'm here now. But, you know, thankfully, it's gone a lot better than I thought it was going to go.
Yeah, you don't want to be the guy in the pub or whatever in 2 years telling all the youngins watching the wrestling because it's a boom and it's popular again. Going, well, back in my day, I could have been a wrestler kind of thing. You don't want to be that one. But so,
exactly.
So from that point onwards, then I've got you noted down as your debut being September last year. Is that right?
Yes,
last year. Yeah. So that's about a year ish training once the schools were kind of opened up a bit more and a bit properly. So was that year off that you had that was just kind of one-to-ones if you were lucky, was that just fuel your fire even more? And when it actually did open, you were just full steam ahead. Did you have a goal in mind? You had to debut in 12 months or were you just trying to learn everything you could for that opportunity?
Yeah, so when we're doing the one-to-ones, apologies, when we're doing the one-to-ones, there was definitely like, there's that fire, like, see when we're constantly just doing all these cardios, you're like, when am I going to actually get to lock up with someone? When am I going to get to start to wrestle someone? There was a bit of like a burning desire there to finally get started. When we started, I guess I did kind of have a goal. I did want to debut within, by the end of 2022, which I did, thankfully. But as time went on, like speaking with people and realizing that that seemed a lot more, like, because there is so many talented people in Scotland wrestling with very few promotions. So there's a lot of competition there. So as time went on, I kind of went, right, maybe I won't hit that goal. And that was okay, I suppose. I try not to really set goals. I suppose I don't really want to set expectations for myself, because if I don't reach it, I will be really disappointed in myself. Mm-hmm. So I try to avoid that. But no, absolutely. When I first started, I did kind of have a goal. By end of 2022, I wanted to have a match, which again, thankfully I did hit. But one thing I've definitely learned from there is don't really set myself like an expectation, but a realistic expectation.
Yeah.
Not like an incredibly high one, like I'm going to be, you know, NXT Europe when it starts. Like, I mean, highly unlikely. I don't want to set myself up for that kind of disappointment or anything like that.
Yeah, that's fine. So yeah, your manageable goals. So like when you already hit the one I had in my mind, like going, right, okay, I made my debut, 12 months, I want to wrestle in ICW kind of thing. That kind of little goals, they got little baby steps, yeah. I suppose, when it comes to career. But yeah, when you're saying debuting within 12 months, that it seems nowadays, though, that's a bit more, I don't know if it's just because of the way that now wrestling coaches are now set up, it's a bit more structured, I suppose, that is doable. Whereas I've talked to some guys in the past, and they didn't debut for 3 years, 4 years, because that was just the way it worked at the time. And then like we were saying right at the start, it's the churning out of very good talent, not just names, but people that look good, look like wrestlers, and not just like they've all the gear, no idea kind of thing, as well. Like,
yeah,
going through the guys that are coming through girders, like yourself, like Landon Riley, Lee McRae, like, you know, there's just a lot of just really solid wrestlers that just seem to debut and be like, okay, kind of thing. On you go. You need to learn a few things, but it's, you got the solid basis. You're fine. You're fine. Which is terrifying, yeah. You know, kind of thing. They're able to be on shows, like, and being solid wrestlers. Because I know for me, I've seen some shows where it's been like, oh, this person's first match, and you watch it and go, yeah, I know. I know that's his first match, because that was not good, kind of thing.
Yeah, I get what you mean though. Yeah.
But when you had that first, so I've got it down as Comic-Con was your debut in a battle royal. That'd be right in thinking that, or was it the GPWA versus Lee McRae?
Yes, the GPWA versus Lee McRae would be my very first one. That was last September.
Excellent. So then,
What
was it like going in front of a crowd? Are you quite an outgoing person when it comes to doing the old hand slaps and come on, guys? Or was that a challenge for you?
So it's very, very true. I'm actually a pretty sort of shy guy, kind of. But I'm kind of an introvert. So I was building up to it. It was a big challenge. And even just before going out of the curtain, I was like, this is going to be, like, I don't know what I'm going to freak out. And of course, Jester, one of the big, like, training points, I was like, you know, you're the very kind of excited, like, happy face. Lee is this really sort of angry heel. So there's like a good dynamic there. Just go out and be like, let's go, come on, get them clapping. So the build up to it, I was like, right, I need to think about doing this. But then you see, as soon as I went through that curtain, it was like a switch. It just kind of was like, it all just came naturally. Just, I didn't even think about it. I was just doing it. And it was very strange. And even to this day, it's like that as soon as I go through the curtain, it's just like a switch. I'm just like instantly like, let's go, everyone, come on. It's like automatic. Mm-hmm. I'm actually at a point where I'm trying to stop doing that so much, but I can't help it. It's just like automatic. It's like I'm on autopilot just saying it. So yeah, it was quite weird because I was the whole lead up, yeah, nervous, but then just went out and it was just coming to me, just saying things, and it was working, I suppose.
So it's just the oddest thing because that's something I've heard quite a lot, that it is before you're behind the curtain, you're not your wrestler character or anything like that, and as soon as you go through, that's it. The person you were is left. You've left them behind for 15 minutes, and you become this wrestler, this whole new character. It's fascinating to hear not just like guys that have just come in like yourself, but like the older guys as well that have the exact same story with that. I'm sure it must be studied at some point in some sort of medical thing, but it's just incredible that. And then, like you're saying, you're introverted. So if someone came to you after the show and was speaking to you away, and you'd probably be like why are you speaking to me, kind of thing. Not in a go away, but like why? But why do you want to speak to me? But yeah, it's just a fascinating thing. So character wise, then. So you're Drew Mercury, clapping hands. Come on, guys. Where did the white stag come from?
So the white stag, so if you're a football fan and you know anything about Ross County, you know that kind of get called the staggies. So the stag is kind of like, I guess, a representation to Dingwall. Like, and stag's kind of like, I guess, Dingwall's animal. And I was just kind of like trying to like list off names. And it was actually someone that I trained with that was kind of like, oh, white stag has like a good symbolization. Why don't you use something like that? So I was Googling it and I was like, it's actually fantastic. So the stag obviously kind of representing Dingwall, but white stag is kind of like a symbolization to kind of just like good, like a good omen. And they're supposed to be rare, they're fast, they're agile, kind of like what I'm like in the ring. But whenever they're hunted in folklore, it's met by like a lot of anger, a lot of sort of pitchforks and torches. And that's kind of like the concept that I was kind of wanting to go, because I'm a good guy. So if a bad guy beats me, it should be met with booze and hatred from the crowd. So that's kind of like the way it should go. So it's kind of like, I guess, mirroring off one another. So yeah, it's like between the fastest and the agile, and then that sort of like being the good guy, being a good omen. That's kind of where it kind of stemmed from.
That's amazing. There's a lot more lore than I thought it was going to be, other than centered really good. So we're gonna go for that.
Yeah.
I like that. I like that when there's a little bit of lore and thought into your names, because, like I say, it could just be a case of I sounded ace, so that's why I've gone with it. But it represents you, it's old Drew Mercury, as all encompassing as the white stag, which is great, fantastic.
Definitely, and it just has got to spring to my mind there as well. Another thing that represents is supposed to be like, if somebody sees a white stag, it's supposed to represent like luck, that person's lucky. And then being from such a small town up north and getting these opportunities, I do. Not only just do I consider myself lucky, I am lucky to be getting what I'm getting. So that's like another little bit of lore behind it.
And of course, for Harry Potter nerds, it's also Patronus. So
exactly. And if I had my glasses on, that's one thing I get told, I look like Harry Potter. Actually, I do have, I don't even know what they are. It's circle, well, it's kind of more like a pentagon kind of shape, my glasses. But yeah, everybody's like Harry Potter. So it's like, yeah, if anybody ever sees me wearing my glasses, kicking about, and then that's been brought up, it's yeah, it'd be good if someone could pick that up. So I suppose, yeah, there you go. Well done.
there you go. And October, I'm sure it'll be a Halloween show that you'll find use for them.
Yeah, exactly.
So moving on from there, I mean, I've got some bits and pieces of matches, because at the moment, because your career is so young, the Germans at Cage Match don't have a profile for you yet. So I've had to do my own research, which is terrible. Ooh. I can't believe it. So you've been really active in the like Central Belt companies, ones with associated with girders, GPWA, Blockbuster as well. But one of your first matches was Wrestling Experience Scotland in Inverness. So that must have been kind of, that's probably as close as you're going to possibly have in recent times of a homecoming match. Were you able to get family down? What were their thoughts with you wrestling, and were they able to see you?
Yes, so they were all there. Quite a lot of my friends and family all got to come and see it. That was sort of a very surreal moment. Like, it was fantastic. Just wrestling in the Ironworks, like, blows my mind. The Ironworks isn't even there anymore. So it was a very limited opportunity I was going to get doing that, and I got it. It was always a bucket list, was that I want to wrestle in the Ironworks one day. And not only that, the fact I got to do it with Lee McRae, because that's who my opponent was, Lee McRae also being from that area, was even more sort of symbolic, I suppose. It was great. It was such a nice, like, two sort of like hometown boys, one good, one bad, getting to sort of face off against one another in their hometown. Well, not so much my hometown, close enough to my hometown.
Home city, yeah. I suppose. So would that be
City, exactly. Yeah. So it was surreal. It was so good. Actually having my name on the Ironworks wall. I mean, I need to probably, before if it's demolished, yeah, I want to go and find that piece of wall, and that's coming home with me. You're not keeping it. Send it to a skip to build a hotel. So yeah. But my family came down to Glasgow as well for the very first one, which was the GPW, the 5 pound wrestling one. They came for that as well. So it was nice having, nice that they came back. They obviously must like what they're seeing. So they came to the Ironworks to watch again.
So what are their thoughts in general? Were they always quite encouraging for you to pursue it? Did they have any like caveats? It's like, you must get your education kind of thing. You must have a fallback. Or were they just all very, very supportive, just going, right, you've set your mind to it. Go do it.
Yeah, there definitely wasn't a lot of, they were the sort of ones that went, yeah, okay. There wasn't a lot of faith that I was actually going to do it. It was one of those things, oh, Drew's just saying that he's going to do it again. But when I actually have gone down and done it, and then I speak back to them, they're all like, fair play. Like, you're doing really well. You've proved us wrong. We always thought that you were like never going to do it. And now they're like really supportive of it, because I guess I am actually doing it. I'm not just saying I'm doing it, I am doing it. And now they are really supportive towards it. They're all like, no, just shoot for what you've got. Keep going. Keep trying your best. Keep doing this. Keep doing that. So, yeah, there's a lot of support there now. But before, again, it's probably just me, my stubbornness going, I'm going to show you. And I did. that's the main thing. And now there's a lot of support.
I'm loving that at the moment, that it seems like the Murray and the Highlands we're talking about producing lots of wrestlers, but yourself, said Lee McRae, we've got Mayhem Brooks, couple folk from Nathan North, I think he's, or Inverurie, close, no, that's Aberdeenshire, that's a whole different thing. But we've got like Ollie, what's his name? I'm going to say Ollie Murs, and that's wrong. Ollie Green. Ollie Green. He will not like that. and Connor Malloy from Forest and stuff like that. It's just great to see that we're not that Murray and the Highlands are kind of just expanding the rest of the country. They're like, oh no, we're not going to stick in Dingwall or the North. We're just going to just kick people's arses everywhere instead. That's just what we'll do. That's a nice little moment with you and Lee, though. Home city, being able to wrestle in the Ironworks, which I've seen wrestling there. It's a very intimate venue, but it's because a music venue as well. The sound carries, and it's just a loud one, regardless of the size of the crowd. At the same time, it was a nice venue to go to shows at. Just a shame that it went down.
It makes no sense. They brought it down to build a hotel. I think the only attraction really in Inverness for anything would be the Ironworks. So it's like, why? Strange, I suppose. Inverness is more kind of about scenery, isn't it? Just being the capital of the Highlands, and it's more hikers and people who are wanting to see the scenery than come to concerts and that. But it seems very a strange decision for them to do it, and it's a shame. It's really sad to see it go.
It really is, because what venues have you got for music now outside of PNJ? If you go north east, if you go east of that, then or west of that, then there's nothing really. We've got the town hall here in Elgin that seems to have a few cool things that comes here, and that's it. There's nothing, you don't hear of any at Buckpart, but even then, that's a big venue to fill. I don't think you're gonna get a lot there outside of huge acts, you know. So it's just really odd. I mean, the only thing I didn't like about Ironworks, it was an absolute pain in the arse to park near because it was on Academy Street.
Yeah,
but you know, that's like, you deal with that.
Kind of thing. Yeah. So having to just park at the Rose Street multi-story and then walk around that, it was a pain to find any kind of parking.
Yeah,
in that area.
I think I parked in the car park once when I was doing some lifts for Rock and Wrestle, and it was just like life in your hands because it's like nobody had any rules where they were parking either. So it was like, okay, my car is here now. I'm hoping it's still here when I come back. So after that, we'll jump about a bit with your Iron Girders and your ICW stuff. So we'll talk about ICW then. So I've got it down here, ICW January 2023 versus Ryan Richards. So that was on Fight TV. So that's not just a big match, but this is actually going to be streamed on a big network like Fight TV. You mentioned nervous before going through the curtain. But when you know that there's the potential of thousands of people or I don't know what their streaming numbers are. We'll say millions of people are going to watch you on Fight TV. Does that ramp up the pressure a bit more?
So actually at that point, I personally didn't know about the Fight TV deal or anything. So going out there, I thought it was just really to the crowd. I knew it was being filmed, but it was mainly just for the crowd. So I didn't really have that additional pressure, thankfully, in the back of my mind. So I think if I knew it was going on Fight TV, there would definitely be a whole rampart of nerves building up there, and like, oh no, like this is going on the network that AEW's on, like that's mental. And that is crazy. And the fact that like there is a match, fair enough, it was only one match, but there's a match of mine somewhere there, which is just, it's quite mind-boggling. It's quite surreal. Again, another surreal, I think everything wrestling is just surreal. Everything that I'm doing is just becoming more and more surreal.
It's one of those things, so you're able to search your name on Fight TV. I'm gathering you can search your name and it'll find that episode and you can find yourself on Fight TV, which is, like you're saying, it's a network, has AEW, and it has thousands of hours of wrestling. You're on it as well. I remember speaking to a lot of the guys that did the closed door tapings for the WWE Network, and one week they would go on the network and it would be them that's the thumbnail and kind of things like that. And it's just one of those things you want to screenshot, and just anytime someone comes around to your house or that, you go, look,
it's a guy. Come on.
There I am on that streaming service kind of thing.
Exactly.
But Ryan Richardson, our guy that's up your way as well. He's a Highland boy, so it's you're spreading.
my first TV debut as well, against another boy from up north, which is, again, I love these little things. Like little things like that mean a lot to me. It probably mean nothing to anyone else, but for me, everything's more about like the meaning behind it. And like, to me, that means a lot. Like, it's really cool having not only just my very first match being with a Northern boy, but my very first TV match with a Northern boy. And it's like, what are the chances it could have been that as well? Mm-hmm. Very slim. And it's happened. And that's something that I will always kind of look back and remember and be grateful for as well.
So I think that's a lot of, because there is that many wrestlers nowadays and they're all vying for the same spots. That's a really great outlook to have. It's just thinking of the moments as well as, of course, you have your goals, your soft goals, the ones that you can make, and then obviously your goals that you want to smash in years to come. But it's really great mindset to have. Just think of the moments, because that's possibly sometimes all you'll get, but at least you'll have them at the same time. Let's talk about Iron Girders then, because you became a little bit of a viral sensation for a moment on the old Twitter during our King of the Fling match, when you escaped your evaded elimination using that parkour ability by kicking yourself off a wall and back into the ring during a King of the Fling match. So Was that always something you had as soon as you saw like kind of the setup for Iron Girders when they put on a show and you saw the kind of close proximity, was that always ticking in your mind when you thought, if I get a match like that, that's an idea that I have, I want to do that?
No, actually, it was kind of one of those, it was more, I never really intended to kind of do anything like that. When they said that there was going to be the King of Fling match, I was like, right, I want to do something that's, you know, evasion. You're trying to avoid getting eliminated. So it was kind of more of a spur of the moment kind of thing. On the day, I was kind of like, you know what, let's see if I've still got the old parkour in me. Let's see if Ezio Auditore and Faith is still kind of living inside me and if I can do it. And yeah, I just came to it, came back, and it was, yeah, it wasn't really a planned thing. It wasn't anything that I like, kind of went in when I first thought, I could do this. It was really just kind of in the moment, kind of as on the day, this is what we could maybe do.
No, that was the clip I saw pop up quite a lot after that match, because it was just everyone just like blowing their mind kind of thing that you did that. My first thought looking at it, because I'm old, was looking at it, not only thinking it was impressive, but I saw the posters that were on the wall thinking, oh, that if you kicked it wrong and that poster just fell down, that would have been so much worse for you.
yeah, just it would have been terrible. It's like one of those things, it's like but there's a whole thing is try to avoid elimination. If that's what eliminated me, is what it is. You know, I'm not expecting to, at that point, I'm just kind of hoping, I'm just trying to stay in the match.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just what do I need to do? What can I put out the bag here that keeps me in it? But I suppose that's the thing with things like King of Fling, just like an over-the-top rope kind of elimination matches. Once you're over that top rope, it's fair game. Whatever happens at that point, if you stay in, fantastic. You try to do something to get back in and you fail, it is what it is. You're out.
I suppose you're young enough as well to kind of be brought up on Kofi Kingston's Royal Rumble exploits and Naomi as well, or Trinity and Impact Wrestling. Yeah. So there's always that's the moment people remember as well. So we're talking about creating moments in your mind, ones you remember, but that's something that someone in the crowd will remember, and they'll come back to the next Iron Girder show because they saw the guy do the, they'll misremember it and say saw the guy do the massive flip off the wall. You know, that's the thing people remember, and it's creating moments and memories for everyone involved. So that's the best,
for sure,
best thing.
I suppose it's great for the fans. You know, they're going to remember that, going to come in, but also for myself, if I'm ever back in a King of Fling match, kind of set myself up for failure there, because an opponent isn't going to try to eliminate me on that side anymore, are they? They're not going to go, Drew's there. No, I'm going somewhere else with him. I'll be again.
I was going to say, I really like
to avoid
the setup
me over that side.
I really like the setup of that venue though, because I think there was a match, I think it was might have been a Battle Royal, one of the first ones, and there's obviously the wall that has all the mirrors in it. And it was the same thing, someone threw someone over the top rope and turned around and saw that they were still in from the mirrors and turned around and eliminated them. I thought that is just beautiful, because that's something that should happen. It's bringing logic into wrestling, which sometimes it shouldn't be brought into it, because you know, Irish whip, you're whipping someone into the ropes, they shouldn't really be coming back. But when you add logic into that kind of thing, it just that's the subtleties and little things that I like. At the moment as well, you're now in a tag team a little bit with Gabriel Saul.
Yes.
So how did that come about? Were you thrown together? Were you working together? How did the team come about?
So it was just it was kind of just us chatting, just kind of like just really wanted to do something a little bit different. As much as I do like singles matches as well, I do like tag team wrestling, and I wanted to sort of get into tag team wrestling a bit as well. And so did he. So we kind of just had a wee chat about it, and just kind of thought, let's give it a bash. We'll see what we can. See what we can get together, see what we can do. So we weren't thrown together, nobody threw us together. It was just us chatting, and let's give it a bash.
So it must have worked out quite well, because at the moment I'm seeing, I spoke to Casino Brutale yesterday for an episode that'll be coming out in the future. And when I was asking about teams they wanted to face, you guys were brought up. So Drew Mercury and Gabriel Saul. So it must be very quick working together as a team, that the chemistry must be just, yeah, it works.
Yeah. Yeah, we do. Yeah, we're doing really well. We do have we've got good chemistry. There's still a few, we're still trying to find our feet, I suppose, with tag team. You know, we went up against Arcade Violence at the last Iron Gunner show at Easterhouse. Went up against those two. And those guys are just, you see, when you put us, like me and Gabriel, exceptionally ordinary in a ring with Arcade Violence, and just seeing how incredible Arcade Violence are. I mean, as much as they're Arcade Violence, and you know they're going to make our lives difficult because they're such a good team, and you know they're dastardly assholes. It's great. Like, we had a lot of fun, but their experience compared to us, it was a challenge. It was hard, and it always will be. With Arcade Violence, it'll always be a challenge. But yeah, Casino Brutale, they're another like team that are just shooting for the stars. And yeah, they're a team that we would really, I know that me and Gabe have talked about it often, they're a team that we would love to go up against as well. And I think this tag scene in Scotland is relatively small, but again, they're all great. And they're at a level that me and Gabriel are still trying to catch up to. And I think we're getting there. We are, but again, even though we did beat Arcade Violence at Easterhouse, it was a challenge. It was hard. And that is something that it's going to continue to be difficult.
Absolutely. I was going to be back at the moment. My dog's trying to come out. So I will be I will just be a second. So I'll just keep it recording and I'll cut it out.
No problem.
A few moments later.
Right, it's fine. I use my wee SpongeBob 2 minutes later thing. Right, so we're back. We're back for those that are listening. I ran away for a bit. So we'll look ahead a little bit of time here. We'll look ahead to the future. This episode's coming out on the 25th of September. And then this weekend, the Saturday coming up, will be Iron Grinders, and you'll be facing Prince Pele. So this is a kind of big night for Iron Grinders as well, for Scottish wrestling in general, because this is going to be the first LGBTQ plus, hoping plus just covers the rest, in Scotland. So yeah, what does it mean for you to be on that show?
It means it's very, very special. So I don't think a lot of people actually know is that I'm gay myself. So being on this show, it's something I never thought like would really happen. Now, I was very ignorant, I suppose, when it came to my knowledge on the LGBT community in wrestling, especially in the UK. And I genuinely thought I was alone when I started. When I first moved down to Glasgow, I thought, am I the only gay wrestler in this country? I Googled it, tried Googling like gay wrestlers or even like bisexual wrestlers, and nothing would come up back in 2019, 2020. So I genuinely thought I was alone in all this. And then went to my first ICW show, there's Shane Monet. I'm like, okay, maybe I'm not alone at least. And then earlier this year, you have Effie's Big Gay Brunch, which I was a part of at TNT. And then being in that locker room with all of these LGBTQ plus people, and then realizing, wow, I'm actually not alone. I really thought it was me against the UK, when a matter of fact, so many people before me walked so I could run. So many people before me crawled so I could walk even. And then having that actually brought up to Scotland, having Iron Grinders and having an LGBTQ plus show in Scotland, and then all this incredible talent, it's again a word that I'm saying often, it's surreal. It's great. I'm not that scared gay little boy anymore, because I'm got people here with me. I've got people that are part of it, and it's definitely been very nice.
Well, it's one of those things. I mean, certainly in the last few years, we've seen wrestlers like Piper Niven, who came out as bisexual, and you mentioned that Shane Monae, of course. Up here we've got Conor Molloy as well, who's gay, and it's just great that people are able to be comfortable enough. And it's never anything that gets brought up on shows now. You know, it's not like it's hurled as an insult either. Whereas maybe pre 2019, certainly when I started watching wrestling, it was Attitude Era, so absolutely it would have been used as a slur. So it's nice to see the world has evolved to a point where it's not a difference maker, whether regardless of your sexual orientation or your beliefs or thoughts or anything, as long as you entertain and are respectful at the same time, then people support you or boo you if they need to in that moment, which is fantastic for everyone. We do have a question about it. Well, Prince Pele himself has contacted us, just asking if you're excited for your match with him, Iron Grinders. You can't wait.
Yes, I am. Yeah, he can't. I know he's. Yeah, I'm really excited for it. I am. Me and Prince Pele, we had a very brief stint at the Effie's Big Gay Brunch. We were in the Rainbow Rumble. There was just a very, very brief moment between us two. And since then, like, I have been looking forward to us having a match, and it's happening up here in my territory. So it's great. I am really looking forward to it. He's a class act. He's a great wrestler. He's taking people by storm in England. So to be able to kind of go up against someone who's also making waves, I'm really looking forward to it.
Fantastic. So while we've got a little bit more, I've got my silly questions. I don't know if you've listened to any of our past podcasts before. We ask two ridiculous questions to everyone. So you're no different, unfortunately. If Scotty thought you could be asked these questions, then you could be asked them. So first up, what's your favourite dinosaur?
My favourite dinosaur? Got to go of pterodactyl. Anything that can fly.
That makes sense. Sure. That's obviously. And another question we ask everyone is, who'd win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep or one cow? Oh, that's a tough one. Two sheep or one cow? Now, I feel like that would be the kind of thing where you think the cow's going to come out on top. You think the cow's just going to absolutely just like steamroll through them. Mm-hmm. But I think one of those sheep is just, they're smart. They're smart. One of them's going to flank the cow and take it by surprise. Something like that. Swipe the legs. You know, I've got to go with the two sheep.
I think I honestly thought I'd get bored of this question by now, because I think I've asked it at least 200 times, and it still brings me joy that people think about it this much. Flank them, double team. They'll do the okay thing going. That's brilliant. There is a video online of a sheep beating up. Well, a cow headbutting a sheep, and then the cow collapses. So, and that's one sheep.
Glass jaw cow.
Yeah. Exactly. So what's it going to do with two? So
exactly.
As we kind of approach a wee wrap up here, we do get in our question through Instagram, which I think is a really nice question that we'll throw in. Maybe a couple more things for looking at the future, and then we'll go on our way, and I'll go and have lunch. And though I always mention food in these podcasts, because so Reagan McAllister has asked, who is your all time dream opponent?
Oh, all-time dream, like hands down, Kenny Omega. For sure, that would be top of the list dream match. Big fan of Kenny Omega.
Are you an AEW guy, or are you just all wrestling kind of guy, or is AEW the promotion you really focus on?
AEW is the one I focus on the most, but I like all wrestling. I'm actually, you know, very, very late to the party. I've been watching so much Lucha Underground at the moment.
From what we've discussed, that sounds absolutely up your street.
Yeah. I tried watching it like years ago, actually, when it was still going on. And you see the kind of whole drama thing about it, I was just not into it. But rewatching it now, I absolutely love it. I'm like, this is fantastic. It's just a breath of fresh air. So I'm enjoying watching a lot of that at the moment. But I'm a very... I like wrestling. AEW is the one that I watch kind of, I guess, religiously. It's the one I like the most. WWE, I always have a love-hate relationship with WWE. I feel like it's a tough one. AEW, I always enjoy NXT.
Yeah, I feel like AEW and NXT are the wrestlers wrestling. Like that's the one they watch. But for fans generally, it's WWE because they're just there for the bright lights and the colors, which is that's what I'm there for. So I'm there for the bright lights and colors and the silliness and all that kind of stuff. Whereas I often find AEW is like that's what wrestlers want to see some wrestling. That's what they go see. So there's no right or wrong.
It's all the indie. It's just indie wrestling, isn't it? And I think there's obviously a lot of like people. Just depend your opinion. You have people enjoy indie wrestling, right? People enjoy wrestling. And I'm an indie wrestler lover. Like I love seeing all the flips. I love seeing the stuff that doesn't make sense. What a shooting star press into a DDT doesn't make sense, but it looks cool. So I'm like, could I do it? Probably not. But it's exciting. I like indie wrestling. So when it comes to, but then again, I actually am at the moment as well going through sort of from the first brand split in WWE. So just before Backlash 2002, and kind of watching up and like even seeing kind of like more WWE style is really great. But
a lot of cruiserweights there as well. That was when the cruiserweight division was starting to really pick up. Good time to get to jump in.
Yeah, and I'm enjoying it. But I think at WWE today, my big problem is I'm not really enjoying. I'm just not relating to any wrestlers as much as I used to like back in the day. Like loved Jeff Hardy. Loved Rey Mysterio, but even like going back and watching that, I'm loving RVD, I'm loving Booker T. Never thought I'd say that. I love Kane. Like, I can't believe that's a word I'm actually stringing together. I love Kane. That's something that I didn't really realize. I always just remember Kane without his mask and just slow, but I'm watching it back and I never knew Kane could move like this.
2001, 2002 Kane is an absolute different animal. Yeah,
it's unreal, and I'm like, I can't believe I'm saying that. So then I watch wrestling today. I'm like Roman Reigns. I enjoy Seth Rollins. I wish there was more AJ Styles, but there's not really any wrestler in WWE that I'm like, wow, I actually want to keep watching this for them.
Yeah,
it's just not hitting me the same way. But then there's like NXT. Like I really enjoy what Gallus is doing. Love watching what they're always up to. And then, of course, I suppose more the sort of kind of gets the flippy side of me. I love what Axiom is doing. Axiom, he's cool. So I do kind of keep on top of NXT, but I'm an indie wrestler, so AEW is my go-to. Said.
There's no wrong answers, I suppose, when it comes to wrestling. As long as you enjoy it, that's the main thing, and let people enjoy it as well. That's the other main thing. Okay, so before we wrap up, then, is there any promotions that you want to get to? Do you have we've talked about your soft goals kind of thing, things that are doable. Do you have any promotions that's out there that you're thinking I would really like to get there, and I think I can in the next 12 months?
12 months? 12 months, I'm not too sure. Like, I like to do more for TNT. I've been down there twice now. In Liverpool, and it's a great promotion. I love TNT. I would like to be back at ICW. That would be great to kind of get invited back and get a wrestle there. But of course, these promotions, and again, it's just in general, like ICW's got a fantastic roster, like so much incredible talent, but there's just no room. And then same with TNT. TNT's got so many incredible talent that I guess there's just no room. Any new promotions? Discovery. I would like to wrestle for Discovery. Keeping it quite close to home. And then just some more promotions down in England as well. I'd like to kind of want to venture out a bit more. I guess kind of like getting down to TNT, it sparked a love for the English scene. And I'm like, I want to get down there. Want to wrestle down there more.
Well, it sounds like with your attitude and outlook, I don't think that none of that is impossible. I think that's something we could possibly, if we revisit this chat in a year's time, you probably would have smashed all those anyway. So before we actually do finally wrap up, where can people find out more about Drew Mercury? What's your socials? Do you have merch? Tell us, plug everything.
Yeah, so I've got no merch. You can find me on Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok. I should actually know all my tags off the top of my head, but they're between, like, it's just Drew Mercury. Some have got a dot, some have got an underscore, but I can tell you exactly which one's got which now.
I can tell you Twitter definitely has underscore. So
underscore, so that means Instagram's got the dot. And then TikTok should be, I think that might be Drew Mercury Wrestler TikTok. Yeah, TikTok is Drew Mercury Wrestler. No dots, no underscores, just all one word. Drew Mercury Excellent. Wrestler.
Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me. I've had an absolute blast. When it comes to newer faces, I always have the fear of going, I've got like three notes. We will have nothing to speak about. But we've had a good chat, and I'm glad that we've got this set up. So good luck for your match on Saturday against Prince Pele. And hopefully we'll get to revisit this in the future.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was great having a chat. Thanks for having me.